We're going to talk about the making of the latest Joe Bonamassa album, which is tentatively titled The Ballad of John Henry, after the lyrics of one of his songs. Kevin Shirley. I'm the producer. I worked with Joe for a couple of years now. This is actually our fourth project together. We did the album You and Me in 2006, and we did Slow Gin in 2007. Also, we've done a live album called Live From Nowhere in Particular, and we just finished a new album, which we did in the studio up in Malibu called Document Room. Now, the process of making a record with Joe is really fun and interesting. When it gets time to make a record, then he sits down and writes. He's not actively writing all the time. He pretty much writes for the records and generally does a couple of covers as well. So this time around, I chose a couple of covers, as I did on the previous two records. And Joe came in with a couple of covers and a couple of original tracks. And we set about doing them. He sends me demos that he records on the road on his computer. They're recorded in the GarageBand on his Mac. And then he burns a CD and he sends me these distorted, tinny demos. But actually, it's fine. I get a good idea of where the song's at like that without it being already sort of produced in any way, shape, or form. And the palette's, you know, blank. You can take it wherever it goes. You have a bunch of great musicians, which are your pots of paint, and then you apply them to the canvas, and the songs turn into these little gems, these masterpieces that they are. So he sent me some of his demos, and he actually was staying at a house of mine down in Malibu for a couple of months after he got off the road, and he set up his amps in the room, and he set up his guitars in the room, and he came in and he wrote for about a month there. And he kept filing these CDs through to me, and this is this song and this is that song. And a couple of them were great. One of them just blew my socks off. It's a song called Spike Driver Blues, which ended up being the opening track on the new album. It's the Ballad of John Henry. And it's recorded with some of my favorite musicians. Anton Figg played drums. Blondie Chaplin, who plays with the Rolling Stones, played guitar. And it's the first time Joe's used a second guitar player. And Blondie just plays this amazing salty rhythm that no one else can play and accompanies Joe. And Joe found it very stimulating working with him and very challenging. And he learned a lot. I think his playing changed a bit as well. So we assembled in the studio up in the big old house up in the hills above Zuma Beach in Malibu. The guys in the band stayed in the house. Carmine Rojas, who's played for years with Stevie Ray Vaughan and David Bowie and Rod Stewart and everyone else under the sun. And he's now in Joe's touring band, plays bass. And Rick Melick, keyboard player from Australia, a friend of mine who I've worked with for years, and who also plays in Joe's touring band, filled out the majority of the first sessions that we did when we cut the first batch of songs. Once we got to the studio, we set about doing a little bit of pre-production before Anton got in, because Anton plays with the Letterman band, so he's got a fixed schedule and could only get down on the Thursday night, and then we had him for 3 days. So that was our first session. So the first part of the week was spent doing pre-production in the recording room with all the guys. So we gathered around in a circle, Rick and Joe and Carmine and myself, and we go through the songs, we run through the arrangements, run through changes that we could do, ways that we could improve the arrangements, you know, how I make sure they suited Joe and the guitar, and suited his voice and his style. And so by the time Anton came in, 4 days later, we had a pretty good sketch of where we were going with those songs. We had to record this album in the month of May because Joe's touring schedule, even though it's only to be released in the beginning of 2009, Joe's touring schedule is so hectic that from the end of May all the way through, you know, the early months of 2009, he doesn't get a break. So we really had to take this time and put it aside and focus on the record and get it done. I just saw a clip on YouTube, actually, of Joe playing Danny Gatlin's guitar when he was 12 years old. So Joe's always had this country blues styling. I think now he's more versatile, but I think that's just him expanding his horizons, that's all. He's just pushing things out there. He's not content to be boxed in, not content to be eking out a living playing the blues circuit. He wants to be, he is, you know, the consummate musician. And he wants to be able to expand that and still keep his blues roots. And that's an intriguing position to be in for him.
Take this hammer, carry it to the captain, tell him I'm going home. Take this hammer, carry it to the captain, tell him why I'm gone. I'm a wanted man with a captain. I'm a wanted man in the shackles. I'm a wanted man in the shackles. I'm a wanted man who killed John Henry in the Battle of Sinners and Saints. Who killed John Henry?
Yeah, we've got some interesting songs on this record. We've got Spike Driver Blues, which was Joe's take on the legend of John Henry in the battle against the machines. The industrial age meets like the slavers and whatever. It's amazing blues song. And then we did, you know, what the bands in the 60s did. We took these blues songs and we made them electric. And it actually came out, I have to say, sounding slightly Zeppish, although that really wasn't the intent at all, but it's ended up that way. And when I looked at it, I was like, well, that's all they were doing. They were electrifying the blues. I love working with Joe. I think he's one of the more talented people around. And he's growing all the time. You know, when I first went to see him a couple of years back, 2005, I went to see him in Chicago. And he was playing in the little blues club with, you know, 200 people, and pretty happy to be doing it at that point. And I went backstage, I watched him play, and we went backstage and had a conversation. And, you know, I thought there was more to him there than just being a blues gunslinger, and I told him so.